learning to tolerate a lot of things in my life now. I can't sleep in anymore, ever. There is no days that I can sleep in. I'm constantly tripping over things. This morning, I ran into a door. I have a knot on my forehead now. There is half-eaten food on my floor, and it's not really something I overly worry about anymore. You know, I tolerate things now because I have a family, and I love them. I love my son, but if I only tolerated him, well, then I would never teach him to get his own breakfast some days. And if I only tolerated him, I'd never teach him to pick up his toys, and I'd never teach him to clean the house. And someday, Colin would never get married. And I have hopes for him. I want to prepare him for his wife someday. And that he would have a good life, that it would all go well with him. I want to pass on not only my faith in Jesus, but how to clean the house and close the doors. There is a difference between tolerance and grace. Tolerance puts up with all of the messes of life. Tolerance puts up with sin. Tolerance puts up with suffering. Tolerance puts up with even death. But grace forgives, and grace does not give up. Grace faces sin, death, and faces suffering, and grace keeps on fighting. On Reformation Sunday today, as we're remembering Martin Luther coming back to the church, and grace was a big theme. And I want to talk about grace today. So I have four theses on grace today. Number one, grace is necessary. Why is grace necessary? Because sin is very real. It is messy out there. It's messy in my house. It's messy in my heart. Sin is real. Romans 3 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." And John 8, Jesus said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin." It is messy out there, and each and every one of us is held captive to sin. And we cannot free ourselves. I follow a lot of blogs of missionaries, and some are in different countries, and some are a little closer to home. One pastor, missionary family I follow is in South Bend, Indiana, and his name is Pastor Ryan. And they move their family to a less desirable neighborhood. And they choose to live there when a lot of people have no choice but to live there. And he wrote this about where he lives. "In the 8 years since my wife and I have moved here, we have seen and experienced all kinds of chaos. We've seen women getting punched in the street outside our house. We've had men come to our house in the middle of the night to try to get money to pay off drug dealers who are waiting in their car by the curb. We've seen friends have their homes invaded and burglarized. And they saw an 80-year-old man beaten. They had partners in ministry robbed at gunpoint, gunfights between neighbors, and vandalism and domestic violence more than you could call the police for. And they choose to raise their kids there. And their families are saying, 'What are you doing?' And in public schools there. And amongst all these other people who don't have a choice to live there. Except for one friend who's from Chicago, and he told him this: 'I would prefer to raise my kids in the hood. In the hood, kids can clearly see right from wrong before their eyes. They can see clear consequences. Violence causes problems. Drugs ruin lives. Mean words tear apart families. And in the rest of society, those problems of sin still exist, but they're just decorated and hidden. Those problems are harder for kids to see, and they're easier for them to unknowingly inherit. We have it pretty easy, and we can't see this every day. And when we have it easy, we let our guard down for sin. And by ignoring sin, it's just the same as tolerating it. It's still there. It's still gonna get us. Ignoring sin doesn't make it less messy, less wrong, or less hurtful. Ask your kids, what are you struggling with? Are you hurting? What are you hurting with? What's wrong in your life? What's wrong in the world? And if you ask a kid that and they say, I'm fine, they're lying. Grace doesn't give up. Grace sticks with it. Grace doesn't tolerate any of that sin, but grace sticks with it. Number two, grace is not earned. Romans 3 says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified by his grace as a gift. And Ephesians 2 says, for by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It's the gift of God. One of the gifts that God gave to me was I was a pretty good student. I was pretty good in high school as a student and went off to college as an honors student and pretty good, got lots of A's. But my first semester, God gave me a gift and I did not get a 4.0. It was a gift. Math was my downfall, and I worked hard at math. I worked in every math class in college that I could, and it was B plus after B plus after B plus. I put in 2 to 3 times the amount of time and effort into those classes. I was in the TA's office. I was in the professor's office. I married my math tutor. I worked hard at math. I tried. And I never got an A in math, no matter how hard I tried, no matter what I did. I could not get an A in math in college at all, no matter how much I wanted it, even if I was a good student, a good person. No matter how much we want to be perfect, no matter how hard we try, how much effort we put into it, we cannot overcome sin in our lives. We cannot overpower the devil. We sang that in our song today. He has a higher power over us. Grace can't be earned either. Grace is a gift that comes from God and God alone. And it's not cheap just because we didn't pay for it, just because grace is something that we couldn't pay for, we didn't earn it at all. It's not cheap. It's very, very expensive on somebody else's part. God the Father gave his perfect son to die. That's how expensive this gift of grace is. It's not cheap. Jesus, the perfect son of God, died so that your sins would be forgiven. What could you ever do to compare to that? What could you ever do to pay off that price that the perfect son of God's gave his life for yours? Grace is given to you freely as a gift, and we can do nothing to earn it. Number two, grace is eternal. No take backs. When you get it, it's yours. God gave it to you. It's unending love. Romans 6 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Life after this one. John 8, Jesus says, truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. You who have been made children of God are now inheritors of his kingdom. And that will never end. Grace will never end. In Luke 15, the people of Jesus' times, who are the religious leaders, the Pharisees, the scribes, all the important people in the church, they're watching Jesus, who is a teacher, a rabbi of God. And he's hanging out with sinners. He's hanging out with thieves, with some people who have really messy lives. And so all the religious people in their nice garb, they're seeing Jesus hanging out with all these messy people. And Jesus tells them this parable. What man who has 100 sheep and has lost one does not leave the 99 and go after that one sheep that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found him, he carries it and he rejoices. And then he calls all of his friends and all of his neighbors together, and he says to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. Just so, Jesus says, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Though you are sinners, though you can't earn it yourselves, the grace of God says that when you belong to Jesus Christ, he doesn't give up on you. You are his eternally. When you wander off, he will come find you. He will not give up on you. Today we have 52 freshmen who will be confirmed this afternoon. Oh, that makes me cry. 52, that's like 20 more than normal. Freshmen who will confirm their faith at Lutheran Church of the Master this afternoon at East Campus. And they are going to remember their baptisms, when God began in their lives their walk of faith, when God gave them that promise that they were a child of God, that His Word was going to come into their lives to work in them faith, and that Holy Spirit was going to remain with them to guide them, to counsel them, to share with them the good news of Jesus, that promise of salvation that comes through Jesus Christ. Now, the past 3 years, when they were in middle school, we had them every Wednesday night at church. And somehow for 3 years, every week, I don't think we taught them how to keep the Ten Commandments perfectly. We tried, but please don't hold it against us. Yes, they are still sinners, but I know that the Word of God was working in their lives, that it was spoken to them, that that faith has been passed on to them, not just from us. Pastors can't do all that, but from their families who brought them to church, from you, the body of Christ, who has worshiped with them, who has encouraged them as they've acolyted, as they've read scriptures, as they served in the church, you who have prayed for these young people, the faith has been passed on to them, and today they will confess that faith in Christ Jesus that says that Jesus died on the cross for them, sinners, and that God overcame sin, death, and the power of the devil in their life through Jesus. And their faith that gives them hope, that even while they face trials and temptations in this world, their faith will tell them that one day Christ will come again and take them to be with their Father in heaven forever. That's what they will confess today. Not their perfection, but the one who has saved them. So we sang this song a little earlier that Martin Luther wrote. Now, he wrote it in German, so if you hear words sound a little different between churches who sing "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," it's because we translated it from German into English. But Martin Luther, people were out to get him, literally. Remember, they all showed up, and here he had put these 95 theses on the door of the church. He was protesting the church, and the church liked their power. They didn't want to give it up very easily. And Martin Luther is starting a reformation to reform, to overthrow the church, to give the power back up to God. And they didn't like it. There were people out to kill him, literally. They wanted to get rid of Martin Luther. And so he writes these words. He says, "Though hordes of devils fill the land, all threatening to devour us, we tremble not. Unmoved we stand. They cannot overpower us. Were they to take our house, goods, honor, child, or spouse, though life be wrenched away, they cannot win the day. The kingdom's ours forever. Grace is eternal, and it cannot be taken from you." For our confirmants today, 52 young people today, grace means that God will never give up on them. Wherever they go in life, whatever they face, whatever challenges, the Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ will be with them to the very end of the age. Number 4, grace changes you. Romans 6 says, "But now you've been set free from sin and have become slaves of God. The fruit you get leads to sanctification, and its end is eternal life." And Romans 12 says, "For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think of himself with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has given, has assigned. And having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them." Whatever your gifts may be, let your love be genuine, Scripture says. Grace changes you. That's not something that you have done, but it's something the Holy Spirit is doing in your life, sanctifying you, making you more like Jesus day after day. Not that we were perfect yet, but that God is not giving up on you. Even if you run away, even if you get lost, even if you have doubts, God says, "You are my child. I'm not done with you yet." Grace not only takes away our sins freely, the debt that we would have to pay, not only gives us that promise of eternal life and life everlasting with Jesus, and that gift that we don't deserve, grace not only promises us that God will never give up on us, but now he changes us. He changes your heart to be more like his. He gives to each of us measures of faith. He gives to each of us gifts of grace so that we can love one another. We can't do that without him. But with him, we can do amazing things. The point of that reformation that we say over and over again as Lutherans is that we are saved by grace alone, through the faith we have in Jesus Christ alone, through that word that we've heard, through the Bible alone, through the death of Jesus Christ alone on the cross. None of it had to do with us. All of it had to do with Jesus Christ. Let us pray.